Members of council, members of the Tamil community, and Brantonians, I would like to welcome you to your City Hall. As acting mayor, I'm delighted to welcome His Excellency, Chief Minister for the Northern Province of Sri Lanka, and his delegation for his inaugural visit to Brampton. As many of you are aware, the Tamil community in Brampton and the Greater Toronto Area plays a very active role in politics, business, and charitable causes. They have shown hard work, perseverance in getting involved in initiatives that in real make a difference. As many of you are aware, the Northern Province is currently in the process of rebuilding itself after a long period of civil war and conflict. As the government led by His Excellency looks to rebuild in areas like infrastructure, healthcare, water, food, and education, the City of Brampton and our local businesses have a real opportunity to lend its expertise and leverage the networks of the Tamil community for a two-way, mutually beneficial economic and social development opportunity. In the upcoming weeks and months, the City of Brampton staff, specifically our staff from Economic Development, will be working with officials at the City of Babunia and the Government of the Northern Provincial to develop a framework and to look for opportunities of cooperation where it will be mutually beneficial. Staff will then bring a report to Council, at which time we will also explore the possibility of an economic or friendship agreement. Over the past weeks, there have been a number of discussions both at the community and city level, and I'm excited about the chance of growing our economic footprint. I know that my council colleagues would agree that any potential agreement should be structured around tangible and trackable deliverables, and not just for the sake of having an agreement. We recognize the importance of symbolic agreements, but we at the City of Brampton are looking towards real actionable items and mutually beneficial opportunities. Providing value both for our economies is extremely important. Tonight's event is to celebrate having the Chief Minister in Brampton. I know that he has had a busy day. He's met with federal MPs, he's met with the Premier, and we look forward to now for him to address the Brampton Tamil community and old friends from within the GTA. Please welcome His Excellency.
Regional Council and Acting Mayor, Members of Parliament, Honourable Councillors, distinguished guests, members of our delegation from Sri Lanka, my dear brothers and sisters. It is indeed a great privilege to be associated with all of you from this part of the globe. I have travelled far to be with all of you. At my age, travelling a long distance is quite a difficult task. Ours is a small country at the southern tip of India, often referred to as the pearl of the Indian Ocean. The fact that a sister city relationship is possible between us, separated by at least a day of traveling by air, speaks well for the globalization that is taking place all around us. The world has shrunk in recent times. Often what takes place in one part of the globe has immediate effect on remote parts of the earth elsewhere. Sometimes I wonder whether the lives of everyone has been predestined in this planet Earth of ours. During our school days, we read about the American missionaries only 150 years earlier, about 150 years from the time when we were in school, about 50, 60 years ago, had traveled by sea 6 months to reach in Jaffna and took a further 6 months sea travel to return to Boston in America. That's how it used to be 150, 200 years ago. Canada was an unknown country to us except by name. We hardly knew much about the humanity here nor their activities except what we gathered from newspapers, radios, and books. The 1983 riots in Sri Lanka has sent so many members of our Tamil communities to many parts of this world, Canada taking pride of place among us for accommodating the most among us. I have my relatives, my friends, students, former clients, and those who work with me during my past in the judiciary and casual acquaintances here. I understand many people who emigrated to other countries in the aftermath of the 1983 riots had a common astrological prediction that they would emigrate around that period in 1983. The predictions had said to individuals parallelly that they would leave their places of birth for other countries at that time. It would be an interesting study to check on the veracity of this statement, which was uttered by many who emigrated from our country. In other words, destiny appears to have pre-planned to take our people to many parts of this globe, and all of you Tamils here are therefore God-selected individuals from us, among us, back home among us. So you are God-selected individuals who have been brought in here. I find Brampton, which is a suburban city in the greater Toronto area, with a population of about 300,000, is Canada's ninth most populous municipality. The total population of Wavunia, with whom we are having a sister relationship, sister city relationship, according to our statistical information 2016 Northern Provincial Council, is 1,90,848, almost 2 lakhs. I find Brampton is one of Canada's most culturally and linguistically diverse municipality, and is the home to a growing and dynamic Tamil community of approximately 20,000 residents who are actively engaged inter alia in commerce, politics, and charitable activities. It speaks well for our dear Tamilian brothers and sisters who, despite their naturalization process which made them become Canadian citizens, they have not forgotten their heritage nor their culture and language. They have come forward through their local authority to strengthen existing economic and cultural ties, while at the same time encouraging commerce and the exchange of goods and services between Brampton in the greater Toronto area and Wavunia within the northern provincial area. We have agreed to come together to collaborate on sectors related to devolved subjects in post-war northern province, in keeping with the provisions of our 13th Amendment, which paved the way for the creation of provincial councils. The 13th Amendment identifies sectors falling within the purview of the provincial council, central government, and those concurrently used. So we have three types of powers: of the central government, of the provincial council, and those used concurrently. In the post-war situation in Sri Lanka, Tamils in Brampton have shown their desire and willingness to take part in rebuilding their erstwhile homeland. And its people, with their financial resources and with the help of their city of Brampton. I'm sure the Brampton Tamils positively believe it would be mutually beneficial to both communities living in Brampton and in Wavunia in the northern province to enter into such a sister city agreement. Your city was once known as the flower town of Canada, I'm told, a title based on your large greenhouse industry. Today, I understand Brampton's major economic sectors include advanced manufacturing, retail administration and logistics, information and community beverages, life sciences and business services. There is no doubt our Wani people in Wavunia could look forward to many cooperative activities with you, which would bring them many benefits. We could also envision a growing awareness and appreciation of each other's culture and way of life. We look forward to many other cooperative activities which will be of mutual benefit to our communities. We would soon identify areas of cooperation when our sister city committee meets to prepare a plan for the initial activities and exchanges. It is our desire to make it possible for Tamils and others in various parts of this globe to develop and improve the quality of living of their counterparts in the war-torn northern province. This has more than mere economic help in mind. That is something that we would like to stress here. There is a need for the haves of education, for the haves of economic well-being, for the haves of skills and capabilities to share their expertise, experiences and excellences with our less fortunate, war-affected humanity. Hence, this sister city arrangement. Let me explain herein very briefly our investment models. Currently, the Northern Provincial Council is working on developing three different types of investment models. One is by collaborating with private-public partnership, and second, in diaspora investment in collaboration with Northern Provincial Council. We have started on a mega project from Middle East based from a Middle East based investor who will invest in the Valley on fruit and vegetable cultivation for export markets. The diaspora investment based garment factory is already operating in our province. The third model is a US based IT related diaspora institute to develop youth, young graduates, school leavers, and those in the government and private sector to acquire greater contemporary IT skills to contribute towards post-war reconstruction and development of our province. In fact, the Prime Minister, our Prime Minister, is welcoming any attempt on our part to make Northern Province as the Silicon Valley of Sri Lanka. He mentioned that just about a month ago. We are very much committed to the full implementation of the UN post-2015 development agenda, consisting of 17 sustainable development goals and 169 indicators, which has been endorsed by our government. So the central government has endorsed, and we too have endorsed. From a macro standpoint particularly, the 16th goal is very much in consonance with our roadmap for water peace transition envisaged for Northern Province over a 15-year timeline. That's from 2015 to 2030. It reads thus, that is the 16th goal. Promote peaceful and inclusive societies for sustainable development. Provide access to justice for all. And build effective, accountable, and inclusive institutions at all levels. Now, this is indeed what we are interested in. Firstly, we need to reduce all forms of violence, especially after the 30-year-old war. It's time for us to get back to normality. The fact that 150,000 armed men belonging to a continual army station in the Northern Province necessarily lays the foundation for violence. They have taken over our lands, they have taken over our livelihoods, our businesses, our resources, and are a threat to the well-being of our war widows and others. Secondly, we need to promote the rule of law at the national and international level and ensure equal access to justice for all. But the continuation of the draconian Prevention of Terrorism Act does not ensure equal access to justice for all. An inclusive society cannot be built upon a counter-terrorism mindset and state security perspective. It has to be changed into people security. The administration must have a humane mindset and people security at heart. People's and human security, or people's or human security perspective, means rule of law at the local government level, provincial level, and national level to ensure human security in our country. Thirdly, we need to develop effective, accountable, and transparent institutions at all levels. While the government have been talking about missing persons being dead or possibly emigrated, the recent findings prove that accountability and transparency are lacking. Fourthly, ensuring responsive, inclusive participation and representative decision-making at all levels has been stressed. Politically, our Northern Provincial Council is being undermined by the central government at all levels. Projects are decided by the center and foisted on us. In short, the provincial councils are thought of as an aberration that needs to be suffered by the government. That's our present predicament. Fifthly, promoting and enforcing non-discriminatory laws and policies for sustainable development is referred to. But discriminatory laws are still in place. Our political prisoners are still harassed and languish in jails. Thus, looking from a macro standpoint, I've not gone into any details. I'm just giving you the parameters of what is taking place there, how things are there politically. Thus, looking from a macro standpoint, I need to say that we have to improve ourselves as a country very much. It is vital that the government of Sri Lanka must be supported by the international community based on the principle of affirmative action to ensure a level playing field. Currently, a team of economic advisors and other provincial council officials are taking stock of the investment climate in terms of post-war northern province requirements, bearing in mind UN Global Compact principles and best practices, and UN post-2015 development agenda of sustainable development goals, which I mentioned a little while ago. They include public utilities, infrastructure such as water, land availability, human resources, their capacity, the nature and type of post-war environment-friendly investment opportunities by sectors, etc. In fact, two of our such officers, Mr. Johnson and Mr. Diranjan, have accompanied me on this visit. We are also currently addressing the policy development aspects relating to post-war economic and private sector development. Mr. Nimalan Karthikeyan is officially helping us in this direction. We are soon to have a one-day workshop headed by university professionals in the related field to collect and compile, thank you, the opinions, demands and interests of investors, both local and foreign. We might also have a joint workshop with sector professionals, and based on our deliberations, we intend preparing a diaspora investment model. Our delay in this direction, working out these economic initiatives so far, can be traced to administrative roadblocks, incapacity of officials, and many other allied reasons. Yet, we are striving hard to move forward nevertheless. Let me identify the issues of investment in our war-affected regions to give you an idea of what we face just now. Firstly, we suffer from inadequate capacities to implement and execute, particularly due to lack of technically qualified personnel and high-caliber management officials in the province. Secondly, lack of basic infrastructural facilities like water supply, electricity, proper drainage system, etc. Thirdly, our inability to create appropriate job opportunities with particular attention to be given to vulnerables, including children, widows, women-headed families, and the disabled. Rehabilitation of ex-combatants too need to be taken note of. We need projects to cater to the unemployed school leavers and unemployed graduates to encourage a culture of innovation and entrepreneurship. Fourthly, our marketing facilities need to be identified, developed, and enhanced. Also, we need to introduce new technology and upgrade our skills and knowledge. I have proposed that our universities and others must research on the construction of low-cost houses, which need to be built with local materials to deal with our housing shortages. The production sector, too, is in need of adequate inputs to make it more viable and efficient. We are also looking into the question of simplifying our procedures, both at the level of local authorities and licensing authorities, to set up one-stop centralized institutions to look into all aspects of investments to make it easier for the investors. It must be remembered that the TNA did not come forward to contest elections initially in the aftermath of the passing of the 13th Amendment and the Provincial Councils Act, saying the law was insufficient and innocuous. It is the same law that we are now working with. Lots of roadblocks are inherent in the system, but we are carrying on regardless, and limited success is perceivable. We expect the twinning programs and the sister city programs to have a positive impact on our performance despite the law. There are possible areas of industrial investments in the Bawunia region which need to be examined. The YALCO, a network of cooperative societies, for example, though it is involved in milk processing, it lacks the governance capacity to compete with large companies coming from the south. Cooperation in this regard with foreign investment sources could go a long way in utilizing the milk produced in the region productively and profitably. Cooperative ventures need to be studied and helped to bring about economic resuscitation at the grassroots level. Currently, we have identified two areas in our province in cooperation with the central government for the establishment of economic zones in line with the concept of the existing successful facility in Damul. One such facility is earmarked in the Vavuniya district. Despite certain hiccup troubles, initially we expect to make progress in the new year, in this year. We have, as a board of ministers, decided to allow small and medium enterprises to flourish in the northern province rather than allow large factories and dubious industrialization. Ours is an agrarian and fisheries-based society. Industries should center around these sectors. We have given importance to tourism, but we are not interested in haphazard hotel and recreational investments which will spoil our environment and jeopardize our cultural ambience. We would insist that our investors do take their skilled and unskilled labor from our local population rather than bring them from outside. Where necessary, the investors must adequately train their labor. This would not apply to the management level officials, of course. We intend having strict controls on the selection of industrial sites. Recently, we came across an investor who got permission to start a business in one area, but preferred to ship with the same documents a few kilometers to the south on the A32 highway without informing us. We have stopped his operations, and now he would be called upon to apply afresh with regard to the earlier land even since his contract has lapsed. We have lots of difficulty from the presence of the army and navy on our lands. You might say why I should mention all these things with regard to the army and navy, which is a negative aspect of our life there, but we would like to give you exactly the present state of affairs. And despite it, I'm sure you will find the ways and means of cooperating with us. We have taken over swaths, they have taken over swaths of land, both inland and on the seashore in the northern province, putting those areas to income-generating businesses, depriving our people of their lands and infra. The army is doing business, taking over lands, using the produce, doing businesses of various types. So the income-generating businesses are depriving our people of their lands and income. There is a wrong perception among the military that lands captured from the Tamil militants belongs to them. I have questioned the soundness of their argument. The war was not with a foreign country. While the war was going on, the writ of the central government did extend into the areas of war in that the government and provincial officials continued their official functions under the central government. Hence, the military has only put out an insurrection, and therefore they must return to their camps and then to their permanent barracks after attending to the insurrection. Somehow, large tracts of lands are still in the hands of the military. In order to improve tourism-related businesses, the military is a stumbling block. They are themselves running hotels and restaurants, and they are occupying areas of tourist value. We are negotiating these matters with the powers that be, but progress is slow. Nevertheless, we would identify potential areas of tourist operation and persuade the armed forces to hand over those areas. In fact, they are at a snail pace giving small areas. Out of the 67,500, about 3,000 acres have been handed back. We still have about 64,500 acres to be given back to us. We are looking forward to areas of collaboration between your city council and our provincial council, most especially in identifying the needs of Vavuniya. I have instructed my strategic advisor to bring together our economic advisors, two of whom are here, with your officials and work out the details. I think that's the way by which we would be able to go forward, because it's useless signing a document and just to be for ceremonially say that we have come together. It must be implemented, and we intend doing just exactly that by getting the officials on both sides to work out the nuances of what needs to be done. Since the Sister City program is a pioneering initiative, we are keen to develop an effective business model which could be even replicated in other developed countries where significant diaspora populations exist. I am looking forward to a mutually beneficial and a healthy collaborative effort on the principles of partnership, which will bring sunshine into the lives of many in our more ravaged province, more specifically at the Vavuniya district level. Let us not forget, even though Sri Lanka is a middle-income country, the northern province is below par and needs Philip to raise its standards with the help of our government and your largesse and technical know-how. This should be possible within a short period of time. I very much look forward to the growth of Canadian and Canadian diaspora investments soon in our areas. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think certainly you've really outlined a roadmap for us to look into and have our staff work with your staff and see what they come back to council with.